Speaking from 1 Peter chapter 2, and as I've been speaking throughout this year, I've been going through 1 Peter with the messages that I've been sharing because the Lord put that book on my heart for 2024, and I hope that I can communicate it in a way that is a blessing to the church as much as it's been a blessing to me. So I respectfully invite you to stand for the reading of the Word of God from 1 Peter chapter 2. I'll be reading verses 13 to 17, verses 13 to 17 from 1 Peter chapter 2. Reading from the ESV, the Word of God says, "Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. This is the will of God, that by doing good, you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honor everyone, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the emperor." Amen. You may be seated. So this passage is particularly relevant for this weekend with the European Parliament elections going on, right? Our church has been a voting location for these elections. And it's also relevant for all of us who live in the United States in the year 2024 because there is a presidential election coming up soon in just a few months. And with this election coming up, there is an increasingly hostile political climate. We all see that. It is obvious. And there is a culture that we live in that is increasingly hostile to God and increasingly hostile to His Word and to Bible-believing Christians. That's a reality. That's something that we see with our eyes and experience. If you turn on the news, it's clear. If you look at social media, that's what you see, that there's this hostility growing. But the scripture reminds us of who we represent and how we should represent him in the midst of all of this. Because primarily, we don't represent a political party or a political leader. We represent Christ. Christ is the ultimate authority. He is the only one, the ultimate one that we submit to. He is the one that we follow. He is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And that's what we have to remember in this political season, in this charged political climate. The Word of God provides us with wisdom to navigate difficult conversations that will naturally arise during this time, during this season. It will guide us and navigate us in making challenging decisions in regards to legislation, in regards to voting for certain individuals. And it will help us have confrontational interactions in a way that is God-honoring, because a confrontational interaction can be God-honoring. Many times these confrontational interactions are filled with anger and shouting, but there is a way to have a confrontational interaction that is honoring to God. Because if we stand for truth and we do it in love, there will still be confrontation. That's the reality. People feel strongly about certain topics and certain issues. But we must depend on God for the guidance and boldness to simultaneously stand for truth and represent Jesus in a loving way. And the commands and principles that Peter presents here in these few verses, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, are shockingly appropriate and relevant to us today, thousands of years later. So we're going to look at several truths that I'm going to present that will guide our lives in this season that we're about to embark on together. That's the unique thing about an election across the country. Everybody has the same results. We're all gonna go through the same thing and we're gonna all experience similar things. So, a few of these truths that Peter presents that are relevant in the context of government, but also in the context of life, these general principles are going to be a guiding light for us. So the first thing that Peter presents is that our submission is for God. Our submission is for God. In verse 13, it says, be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution. For the Lord's sake, we're called to be subject to government institution. The human nature is one of rebellion. We do not like to be told what to do. Maybe you know people in your lives that are a little bit more this way than others. But in our nature, from the very beginning, from the fall of man to now, humans don't like to be told what to do. We don't like God to tell us what to do. In our selfishness, in our flesh, in our human nature, we are opposed to God. We're rebellious to God. And even more so, we don't like people to tell us what to do. But the challenge with that is that the way God works, the way God initiates his authority in the world and in our lives is through people many times. He places people in position of authority that we're called to be subject to. That happens in the church, right? In Ephesians 4, it talks about different offices in the church: apostles, prophets, evangelists, shepherds, teachers. There's deacons, there's people with different positions of authority and responsibilities that God uses to create order and structure. And in the same way, he does this in government. We don't think of it many times. We think of it in the church, but in government, sometimes we look at government and just think that's just a man-made thing. But actually, God does the same thing. That's what Peter highlights here in 1 Peter chapter 2. And that's what Paul, when he writes to the Romans in chapter 13, points out so clearly and strongly. Romans 13, verse 1 and 2, Paul writes, let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. God speaks very seriously on this matter. God ordained things in a certain way and set things up in a certain way. And when we rebel against that, we're rebelling against God, is what Paul is writing. Because God gives his authority to people for the sake of order. People submit to officials, officials submit to the king, and the king ultimately submits to God. And you read this and you look at what Peter is saying and what Paul is saying and you think, surely they can't be talking to us here today in 2024. Have you seen our leaders? Have you seen what they stand for? Have you seen their principles? The people that we're under the authority of, they don't honor God. They don't fear God. They don't live by his word. How can Paul and Peter be instructing us to be subject to this kind of authority? But let me remind you who they are writing to. In the first century, when Peter is writing this letter, he's writing it from Rome. Paul, writing to the Romans, who are around the same time period, the king during that time is Nero. And if you're familiar with the historical context, Nero wasn't very friendly to Christians. He instituted government-sanctioned persecution of Christians that would last for centuries. And yet, Peter and Paul are saying, be subject to government institution. And if those Christians are given this command, surely this applies to us today too. As difficult as it might be, we're called to submit to this design that God has, because when we respect that design, we are ultimately submitting to God. And when we don't respect that, then we are in direct rebellion against God, as it says in Romans 13:2. Throughout the last couple election cycles, maybe you've heard people say, for both administrations, the Trump administration, the Biden administration, people weren't happy with who was in office, and they said, that's not my president. You've seen that, right? But that's unbiblical. That's unbiblical. That's not what God calls us to do. And he challenges us in this way. That's what God does through his word. His word always challenges us. Are we willing to submit? Because the human nature is to go to rebel. But God says, be subject to this. However, it is clear that these people that God ordains and puts in positions of authority and allows to be in his sovereign will, allows to go into office in these places, they overstep the authority given to them by God. Because Peter writes in verse 14 that the authority given to them is to reward or to praise good and to punish evil. That's the authority that's given to them. That's the responsibility of people in authority. But What they do when the word of God is not guiding their principles, when the word of God is not guiding them, and they don't fear God, and they don't know Christ, what they do is that they redefine good and evil. And before you know it, what God says is good, they say is evil, and what God says is evil, they say is good. That is clear in society, is it not? As Isaiah 5 verse 20 highlights that, they will say what is good is evil and evil is good. And we see in culture that people who are doing good are being punished as if they're doing evil, and people who are doing evil are being rewarded as if they're doing good. But we must remember when that there is this contradiction, when there is these two principles that are in tension, that we're supposed to be subject to authority, but at the same time, we're supposed to honor God and do good. When these things are in tension, we must remember who is the ultimate authority and that the ultimate authority belongs to God. Peter himself experienced this exact thing. In Acts chapter 5, Peter and the apostles are commanded, don't preach the gospel, don't preach Jesus Christ anymore, by the high priests and the council, and they're brought to be questioned. And the high priest says to them, we strictly charged you not to teach in this name, yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you intend to bring this man's blood upon us. But Peter and the apostles answered, we must obey God rather than men. We obey God first and foremost. We're called to subject ourselves to human authority because God has ordained that authority, but when that authority fails to obey God's word and commands us to do something against God's word, we remain faithful to God first and foremost and to his word. Amen. So our submission is for God. Second, our freedom is for serving. Our freedom is for serving. In verse 16, Peter writes, live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. That's why we've been set free. As Christians, we have a unique freedom. A unique freedom from sin and the law because we are free in Christ and we have a special position as sons and daughters of the living God. But that position is not to be used to cover up evil. It's used to serve God, and we serve God by serving people. And this idea to use freedom to cover up evil, I thought about it and I was thinking about it for a while because it's kind of a unique one that we don't talk about too often. But if you really think about it, people use their freedom, their position as Christians, to do evil all the time. All the time. In the name of God, people do evil things all the time. I've seen it for myself. Maybe you've seen it. People who are trying to take a stand for something that is righteous, something that is good. I've seen people protesting against abortion, rightfully so, standing for what is right and true, and they're approached in a violent and hostile manner by people who are opposed to their stance, by people who say, no, you shouldn't be against abortion, and they come with hostility and anger, cursing them. And these Christians who are standing for the truth, they're doing a good thing. In their weakness, in their human nature, they respond with more hostility. And then all of a sudden, they've lost their witness because they fail. They fail to stand for truth. They fail to remember what they're actually called to do, which is to serve God with their freedom and serve people with their freedom. Jesus tells us in Matthew 5:43, you have heard it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good. He sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. This is a challenging text. God is challenging us as Christians in a world that hates him to love them, even though they hate them, even though they hate what we stand for, even though they hate God and his word, we're called to love them. It's not easy, and it's only possible by the Holy Spirit and the work of God inside of us. Our freedom is meant for serving. Thirdly, Peter highlights that our honor is for everyone. In verse 17, honor everyone. Couldn't be more clear. Another challenge for us as believers. Honor everyone. No exceptions, no bias, no partiality. Honor everyone. And to be very, very clear, Honor is not obedience. Honor is not even agreement. The word honor in the Greek is timeo, which means to give value to recognize the value of. And so Peter is saying, recognize the value of everybody. Because every single person you see, whether you agree with them politically or not, whether they are believers or not, they have value in the sight of God because they have been created in the image of God. And you and I, maybe we're a step ahead of them. We already know Christ. We've received his grace. We've been saved. We're a step ahead of them, but that does not give us the right to have spiritual pride and think we're better than them, because they too need Christ. They too need his grace. They too need deliverance. They too need to be saved like you and I, to have that life-giving hope. Honor everyone. See the value in everyone, even if you disagree with them. If you truly value someone, you will pray for them. Think about the people closest to you. Your sons, your daughters, your parents, your grandparents, your children, your grandchildren, your closest friends. Those people are easy to pray for, right? Because you value them. You see the value in them. You see the value that they have in your life. But the same way you value those people, God values the people who you disagree with. So we need to pray for those people. We need to pray for those we disagree with. We need to pray for those in government. Peter says, honor the king, honor the emperor. What a challenge. It's really easy to look at the people in office and say, that person, you know, is against God, and therefore I'm against them. And we dehumanize them, and we forget that they too need Christ. We can complain about them all we want. We can complain about their legislation and what they do all we want. But if they do not receive Christ and know Christ and fear God, they will never change their policies. And our country will never change. That is the need. That's what we need to pray for. In this next few months, approaching this election cycle, we need to pray that God will put people in office that fear him, and to change the hearts of those in office to fear him and seek him and know him, because God can transform lives. That's the only way that we're gonna see a country that comes back to God. That's the only way we're gonna see a country that has another great awakening, is if God intervenes. We must pray for them. Fourthly, Peter highlights, our love is for a purpose. He says, almost out of nowhere, he says, love the brotherhood. And this love for the brotherhood has a purpose. It's not just to say love, you know, because Christians, you know, we're supposed to love. He's not just saying it for no reason. There's a purpose that he says, love the brotherhood. We as a community, the Christian community, not just our church, but all churches, Bible-believing, Bible-teaching churches, when the turmoil arises, because surely it will, when things get chaotic in this country, because surely they will, we need to love each other and support each other and help each other and encourage each other to remain steadfast when challenges come our way. You need to know you have a body of believers behind you supporting you and what you stand for. Because it is hard to stand for truth when you're standing alone. But when you're standing with others, it is much easier to remain steadfast in God and what the truth of his word is. And secondly, when I read this, when I read Peter write, love the brotherhood, I remember John 13, verse 35, where Jesus is preaching to the disciples. Peter is there, and he says, by this all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. So when there's chaos in the country, when there's civil unrest, but the church is coming together and the church loves each other, people will see Christ through that. And when they look at the church and they see Christ, they're gonna say, I want something like that. I want that peace. I don't want this unrest. I don't want this uncertainty. I want the peace and the joy and the love that is in the church. That's what we're called to. That's what we're called to represent. Our love is for a purpose. Love the brotherhood. And lastly, Peter writes, fear God. Our fear is for God. Fear God. The fear of God is absolutely necessary in this time. That's what lacks in our country. That's why the country is decaying. That's why culture is decaying, because there is no fear of God. But we as Christians who are called to be salt and light, salt that is a preservative, preserving the culture, We can only do so with the fear of God, because the fear of God keeps us on the path of righteousness, away from compromise. Not remaining silent when we should speak up, but standing steadfast and proclaiming the truth with the fear of God. The fear of God is the command here in these verses that is really the driving command behind all of it. Because if I fear God, I'm going to subject myself to authority. And when that authority tells me to go against God, because I fear God, I will not obey. I will only obey God, and I will not obey man. If I fear God, I'm going to love the brotherhood. If I fear God, I'm going to honor everyone because they are made in his image. If I fear God, I'm going to do good, and I'm not going to use my freedom to cover up evil. The fear of God drives all of this forward. And the fear of God helps us eliminate the fear of man in our lives. Matthew 10, 28, and do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. When we fear God, man has nothing on us, because God's power is so much greater. And we know we belong to him. We need wisdom to navigate this. We need wisdom to navigate this season, these elections, this culture. And the fear of God is the answer for that too. Proverbs 9, verse 10, the first part. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. We need this fear, this healthy fear of God that Peter points these believers to. So our submission honors God. Our freedom is for serving. Our honor is for everyone. Our love is for a purpose. And our fear is for God alone. And there's a beautiful, beautiful picture in scripture of this. The perfect example of some godly young men who were able to balance this tension of respecting authority but standing firm in God. And that comes back in the Old Testament in Daniel, with Hananiah, Azariah, Mishael, and Daniel himself. You know, Hananiah, Azariah, and Mishael, they were told, you must bow before this statue of Nebuchadnezzar. You must bow before him. And they said, pretty much in simple terms, respectfully, no. Because I serve God. Because I've served God. And they were thrown into the fire because of it. But they came out not even smelling of smoke, because God was with them. There's another in the fire. So when we stand firm, we're going to go through fires, but we're not going to go through them alone, because God is with us. Daniel himself, he was told, worship no other God except the king. And Daniel said, I'm sorry, I'm going to the second level of my apartment. I'm opening the windows wide. I'm getting on my knees and I'm worshiping God, no matter what you say. Respectfully, I have to worship my God. When the world says, kneel before these false gods, we say, no, I'm going to stand. When the world says, stand, don't worship your God, we say, no, I'm going to kneel and worship. That's our call. That's how we stand firm. We must balance these two things. And it is by the power of God that lives inside of us that we're able to do this effectively and in a God-honoring way, standing firm in truth and proclaiming the love of Christ to the world. May God help us all. Amen.